In the Old Testament, Jesus said, "All who hate me love death." Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Accepting him as your Lord and Savior and choosing to follow him puts you on the way. Obeying the truth of God's word keeps you on the way that ends in eternal life. Your eternal destiny will be determined by your choices in this world. Steps to Life exists to help people find the way, the truth, and the life.
Father in heaven, as we open your word now to study it, we earnestly pray that your Spirit will teach us the truth that we need to understand if we are going to be in the kingdom of heaven. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. By the way, if this subject wasn't so hard to preach about, if it wasn't so important, I wouldn't preach about it. But it's very important because millions of people will be lost because they didn't understand this subject, didn't experience this subject. So to get started, let's go to our scripture today that we were reading in Philippians, the second chapter. Let's start reading in verse 3. Let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than himself. Let each of you look out not only for his own interests, but also for the interests of others. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. What kind of a mind was in Christ Jesus? Now he's going to explain that. Here's what he says. Who being in the form of God, let's stop right there. Does God have a form? Yes, he does. Before man was created, God said in Genesis, the first chapter, let us make man in our image. If people understood that a human being was formed in the image of God, they would have a horror of abortion. The human race did not come from monkeys or something like that. It wasn't a big bang. We were created in the beginning in the image of God. And the way that I treat you, the way you treat me, the way that we treat each other is accounted in heaven as the way that we treat God, because we are dealing with people that are created in the image of God. And Jesus says he was in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God. That, by the way, is a hard word to translate from the Greek, so different translators translate it different ways. Some translators translate that word as he did not think it was a thing to be grasped or to be held on to be equal with God. By the way, does this verse teach that Jesus Christ is equal with God? Yes, it does. And that is something that somehow our Aryan friends have a hard time getting a hold of. The people that are all confused about the Godhead controversies today don't understand that Jesus Christ is equal with God. There, by the way, there are many, many statements in the Ellen White writings, as well as in the Bible, showing that Jesus Christ is equal with God. Our Arian friends to try to oppose that, say, they quote John 14, 28, where Jesus said, the Father is greater than I. Someday, if the Lord wills, I'll preach a sermon on that subject. They don't understand what they're talking about, and they don't understand the context of that verse. I have learned when studying with Arian people that they take texts of Scripture that are referring specifically to the humanity of Christ and try to apply them to His divinity, and it doesn't work. Jesus was in the form of God. He was equal with God. He was equal with the Father. To differentiate between the two in the Bible, and we do this often, to differentiate between the Father and the Son, the Bible writers apply the term God to the Father, and they apply the term Lord to Jesus Christ. My brother actually discovered this before I did. He told me one time, he said, if you look through the Bible and when you find the expression Lord God, he says, you check it out, you find out almost every time it's talking about Jesus Christ when it uses the term Lord God. So now that's interesting. You can check that out yourself if you want to. But Jesus was equal with God. He was equal with the Father. You cannot understand what we're going to read next until you first understand that. If you do not understand that Jesus is equal with the Father, you cannot understand what we're going to look at and what we're going to study. Is the Father omnipotent, all-powerful? Yes. Was Jesus Christ omnipotent, all-powerful? Yes. Does God the Father have all knowledge, what we call omniscience? Yes. Does Jesus Christ have all knowledge? Yes, He does. He was equal with the Father. Ellen White says, He was used to absolute power. My dear friends, the government of heaven is not a democracy or a republic or something like that. The government of heaven is a kingdom. By the way, that's where the devil and the evil men got the ideas of having kingdoms down in this world, because the devil knew that up in heaven they had a kingdom. They have a kingdom up there, and they have a king there. Now, if this is soaking into your mind, if you realize that Jesus Christ is at the top, He is equal with God the Father. He is not some lower level of being. He is not in some way subservient. He is equal with the Father. Now notice what happens. Verse 7. But made Himself of no reputation. There came a time when He took off His royal robe and left it in heaven. He had a crown because He was a king, and He left His crown in heaven. He had a scepter. Oh, I would love to. If the Lord wills, I would love someday to preach you a sermon about the scepter. Jesus Christ had a scepter that involved having absolute power. He laid that down. He left His throne. He left His crown. He left His scepter, that absolute power and authority. You and I have no idea what we're talking about. Ellen White says that when we get to heaven and we see how wonderful it is and we begin to realize that Jesus Christ left this and became an exile from the heavenly courts to come down here to save the human race, then we'll start to understand what He left. We don't understand it yet. But He left it And he came down here to become a human being. We don't understand that either. Somebody says, well, it wouldn't be awful to be a human being. No, it's not awful to be a human being, but it's so much different from what he was. But that was just the beginning. When he came down here to become a human being, he was born into a poor family. He was born, you know, when I was a child. I'm not saying that my father did right by this, but my father grew up on a farm. My father knew about milking cows and taking care of hogs and chickens and all kinds of livestock and doing all kinds of farm work. And they had certain expressions that they used. If you were somebody that was a very careless driver, my father would say, well, he drives like a farmer. Well, that maybe is not the best thing to say, because farmers aren't necessarily bad drivers, but that was just an expression. And if you were sloppy in doing something, my father said, what are you, a farmer? And I thought, what is it? He grew up on a farm, and yet he'd use this expression. And if you didn't pick up or left the door shut, on shut, and just left something, my father would say, what's the matter with you? Were you born in a barn? I thought, oh. Just an expression that they had. I don't know where that expression came from, but in my father's family, that was an expression. If your child was a little bit careless, you ask, well, what's the matter with you? Were you born in a barn? My dear friends, Jesus Christ was born in a stable that his parents didn't even own. They were just allowed to stay there for the night. And so it says here that he was taking the form of a servant. He did not come to this world to have other people serve him. He came to this world to serve other people. He says, coming in the likeness of men. He was a real man. He united his divinity with humanity. Now, that's something that we'll never understand totally, I believe. But it happened. The Bible says it happened. But now notice what happens. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. When you study the life of Jesus, first, it was like an infinite condescension to come from glory and to come down here to become a human being. That would be an infinite condescension that we can't even understand that. But then, what we just read, then he came not to be served, but to serve. He came as a servant. By the way, if you want to study that, the whole Gospel of Mark is written from the standpoint of showing you that Jesus came to this world as a servant. That's one of the main themes of the Gospel of Mark. Being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. He did not die as a hero. You know, we honor men that have died in combat, don't we? We honor them. We say, we're sorry for what happened to them, but they died for their country. And we want to honor people that have died for their country so that we could still exist as a free country. But Jesus didn't die as a hero. He died as a criminal. Now, what we've just been talking about is so astonishing and so amazing that the angels don't understand it. Let me read you a little bit about it from the pen of Ellen White. This is from the book Sons and Daughters of God, page 81. He says, "The humiliation of the man Christ Jesus is incomprehensible to the human mind, but his divinity and his existence before the world was formed can never be doubted by those who believe the Word of God. The Apostle Paul speaks of our Mediator, the only begotten Son of God, who in a state of glory was in the form of God, the commander of all the heavenly hosts, and who, when he clothed his divinity with humanity, took upon him the form of a servant. In consenting to become man, Christ manifested a humility that is the marvel of the heavenly intelligences. The act of consenting to be a man would be no humiliation were it not for the fact of Christ's exalted preexistence. We must open our understanding to realize that Christ laid aside his royal robe, his kingly crown, his high command, and clothed his divinity with humanity, that he might meet man where he was and bring to the human family moral power to become the sons and daughters of God. To redeem man, Christ became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross." What is the most difficult sermon to preach? What is the hardest sermon to practice? The most difficult sermon to preach is about the subject of self-denial and humility. That's the most difficult sermon to preach. That's the hardest sermon to practice. And we just read about the example of Jesus. An example of humility that is unparalleled, that we even when we get to heaven, I'm not sure that we'll be able to comprehend it or understand it. I'm going to give you a test. Not that I'm going to give you a test. I'm going to give you a test, and you can apply the test yourself. I'm going to give you a way to test yourself. This is how to know if you are learning the lesson of self-denial and humility. This is a test. Just has one question. And your answer to this question will show, it'll show to you, and it'll also show to everybody around you, whether you are learning the lesson of self-denial and humility or not. Here's the test. Here's the question. It's just one question test. How easily do you become offended because of the faults or failures of another person over something that he or she has done that has injured you? That'll tell every time whether you're learning the lesson of self-denial and humility. Here it is again. Here's the question. How easily do you become offended because of the faults or failures of another person over something that he has or she has done to injure you? Have you ever been in a situation where, somebody says, I could deal with it if it was a godly enemy, but here it's somebody in the church. Oh, it's a deacon that did it, or it's an elder, or it's a pastor. That's harder, isn't it? They're not supposed to do anything that would injure you or offend you or whatever. The Bible talks about that. David said, if it was an enemy, I could have stood it. But it was a friend. There are many, many examples in the Scripture about this. In John, the 6th chapter, this is the day after the feeding of the 5,000. We will not take, we're running out of time already, so we won't take time to read it. It was the day after the feeding of the 5,000, and when Jesus explained to them, and when they understood what that bread represented, Jesus says, I am the living bread, the bread of life. When they understood that Jesus had not come to establish a temporal kingdom to overthrow the Romans, that he had come to establish a spiritual kingdom, not a temporal kingdom in this world, when they understood that, they said, this is too much. They said, this is a hard saying. Who can even listen to this? Because it was contrary. It was contrary to what they had been taught and what they had thought their whole life. And my dear friends, when somebody is told something that is contrary to something that they have thought and believed for a very long time, almost every time the person says, well, that couldn't be so. You ever heard that? Oh, that couldn't be so. That's what they said. They became offended, but the 12 disciples did not. But you'll read in that same chapter that Jesus said to them, when he asked them, he said, are you going to go too? And then Peter said, well, who are we going to go to? You have the words of eternal life, and we have believed that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus said, have I not chosen you 12, and yet one of you is a demon? He was speaking of Judas Iscariot. This was approximately 1 year before the crucifixion. The night that Jesus was betrayed, he told his disciples in the upper room, he said, one of you is going to betray me. And then when they left the upper room, they still didn't know who it was. When they left the upper room, that was it. The upper room, by the way, was in Jerusalem, the city of Jerusalem. They went down the street. The streets were crowded because it was Passover time. There was lots of people. I've tried to imagine in my mind what it must have been like. Jesus and 11 disciples walking down the street toward the eastern gate. Streets crowded with people. The majesty of heaven in the form of human flesh is in this world, and he's walking with his disciples down the street. People don't even understand. People don't even know who it is. You walk down, they go to the eastern gate, and he goes out, and they head toward the Mount of Olives. And then Jesus says to his disciples, Ellen White says he said it in a tone that sounded like his heart was broken. He said, all of you are going to be offended because of me this night. Had the disciples been taught in the Jewish synagogue that when the Messiah came, that the Messiah was going to be crucified or anything like that, had they been taught that? No, they hadn't been taught anything about that. It was going to be totally different than everything that they'd ever been taught or thought about the coming of the Messiah. Well, Jesus said, all of you are going to be offended. Peter said, well, if everybody else is, I won't. The story shows us that we don't know ourselves. The Lord knows us, but we don't know ourselves. Is something like this going to happen again? It is. Here's what Ellen White wrote in the Review and Herald, December 20, 1898. Whenever persecution takes place, the spectators make decisions either for or against Christ. Because of persecution, many will be offended. Many who have professed to love the truth will then show that they have no vital union with the true vine. They will be cut away as branches that bear no fruit and will be bound up with unbelievers, scoffers, and mockers. Those who apostatize in time of trial will bear false witness and betray their brethren to secure their own safety. They will tell where their brethren are concealed, putting the wolves on their track. Christ has warned us of this, that we may not be surprised at the cruel, unnatural course pursued by friends and relatives. Now, if you talk to those people today, they'd say, I'd never do anything like that. Well, that's what Peter said. I'd never do anything like that. All the disciples said, we'll never forsake you. They all said that. What happens when somebody in the church wants to do something different than other people think it should be? How do we relate? Ministers have this problem too. And Ellen White wrote about this on a number of occasions. Here's one place where she wrote about it. She said, ministers of experience who realize the sacredness of the work and feel the weight of the cause upon them are jealous of themselves. They consider it a privilege to advise with their brethren and are not offended if improvements are suggested in their plans of labor or in their manner of speaking. They're not offended if somebody suggests, I think there's a way we can improve this. They're not offended if somebody says, I think that you should speak like this. By the way, my wife used to give me counsel on my manner of speaking. When I was a young minister, I needed lots of help and lots of advice. Since I've been at Steps to Life, I get advice from all over the world now on what people think, and I pray that the Lord will help me to take cognizance of what I need to take to learn how to speak. When Jesus came to this world, I've already intimated, talked not just at the close of his life, but during his life in this world, not just at the close, but during the time he was living in this world, he was not treated very well. And one of the interesting things that I have noticed as I've studied the life of Christ is that he did not become offended over different things that happened. And I want to read to you something interesting about this. These are some of the people that Christ met up with. Even those who had fallen the lowest, he treated with respect. What is a person that has fallen the lowest? That's fallen the lowest in crime, fallen the lowest in sin, whatever you think the lowest is, Christ met up with these kind of people. It was continual pain to Christ to be brought into contact with enmity, depravity, and impurity. But never did he utter one expression to show that his sensibilities were shocked or his refined tastes offended. Whatever the evil habits, the strong prejudices, or the overbearing passions of human beings, he met them all with pitying tenderness. As we partake of his spirit, we shall regard all men as brethren with similar temptations and trials, often falling and struggling to rise again, battling with discouragements and difficulties, craving sympathy and help. Then we shall meet them in such a way as not to discourage or repel them, but to awaken hope in their hearts. When we become like Jesus, we will consider all men as brothers who, like us, have struggles, and who sometimes fall and then have to rise, and whom the devil's trying to discourage and saying, you'll never make it. Not even going to be worthwhile for you to try to get up again. Jesus met all these people. And when he met them, the most sinful, he showed them that there was hope for them, that they could get up and live a different life, that divine, the angels of heaven would help them to change their life and to live a different life. One of the things that makes human beings offended is if somebody says something to reprove or rebuke them. That is so difficult for human beings to take that most of the time, I don't know the percentage, but almost all the time, it is rejected. And often the person that does such a thing is then held in contempt and becomes an enemy. And ministers know this, and so giving a reproof or a rebuke is very unpopular for ministers. They don't want to do it because they're like just like Aaron. They know what the consequences could be. So, what will happen? Well, people will become offended and leave the church. Here's how it happens. Ellen White said, some in the church will prove to be false brethren. Their faith, their love, their patience, their constancy will be tested and tried. By the way, how will it be tested and tried? It'll be tested and tried by faults or failures that they see in other people. That's how they get tested and tried. If everything was perfectly smooth, then there would be no test nor a trial. If they are not rooted and grounded in the truth, if they are not filled with the fruits of righteousness, which are by Jesus Christ unto the glory and the praise of God, they will become offended at reproofs and warnings, will not humble their souls before God, and will go back and walk no more with those who love the truth. So, does that happen? My dear friends, there are many people right in this town, this area. They used to come to church here every single week, some of them for years. But the world got a hold of them again. They became offended over something. I could state to you certain things that happened at certain times that different individuals took offense at. And when I see these things happen, I very often think of what my late brother Marshall used to say about it. My brother used to say, no excuse is going to be good enough if you're lost. No excuse will be good enough. You may have all kinds of justification and say all the reasons. It's because of this person, that person, the other person, all what they said, what they did. Is that going to be a good enough excuse if you're on the outside at the end? See, the reason that people become offended over all these things that happen is because we don't have the humility that Jesus had. I'm not pointing a finger, I'm including myself. And of course, humility leads a person to deny self for the good of others. That's one category of people. Then there's another category of people in the church. And they don't cherish a right spirit toward their brothers and sisters. And Ellen White says their problem is that self-esteem has been cherished, and they have a spirit of criticism because they have not been put in the proper place. They weren't treated right. And so He says, envy, jealousy, suspicion, fault finding, and false witnessing have existed. There are unconsecrated hearts among you who turn everything said or done, even under the special direction of God, in a wrong way. The power of Satan's temptations is strong upon these, and they view things in a perverted light. They please the enemy by their criticisms and by making a man an offender for a word. In many of these cases that are criticized, there is no actual sin. The suspicion is the result of the condition of the mind that entertains it. If one crosses their path, they have no unity or fellowship with him. They feel disgusted with all he may say or do. Those who have confidence in them share their feelings and sentiments. A spirit of retaliation is secretly at work. Yet, those who are thus creating disaffection and disunion and planting the seeds of jealousy all the while claim to be firm believers in the truth. They say they're firm believers in the truth. And so, what is the devil trying to do in every church all over the world? What the devil is trying to do in every church, especially Sabbath-keeping churches, especially Adventist churches, the devil is trying to keep the church in a state of wrangling and envy and jealousy. Have you ever been slighted by somebody that you said to yourself, that's impossible. How could that person be an elder or a deacon or a Sabbath school teacher or a pastor? How could they be that and do this? How could they do this to me? Have you ever heard somebody talk like that? I want to read you what Ellen White said about that. She said, if you had the Spirit of Christ, you would not notice slights and make much of fancied injuries. Men often commit wrong through ignorance and want of judgment. In many instances, there is no premeditated wrong. It is caused through a lack of thoughtfulness. The one who treats this as sin is himself a sinner. There is with many a keen imagination that makes them an offender for word or action, but often the one judged is innocent in the sight of God. The accuser who has permitted the tempter to ruffle his feelings needs to humble his soul before God to be purified and refined by the Holy Spirit, to love his brother and be kind and courteous. If one errs, remember that this is no more than you yourself have done. By the way, that's not me talking to you. I read that. I didn't make that up. I read that. You ever wondered why there are so many churches and there's so many churches that split and then have you heard of churches splitting up and part of the church goes this way? How does this all happen? Did you know, why are there so many denominations? Why are there so many different kind of churches? I'm going to read it to you. Ellen White's going to explain to you exactly how it happened. In one paragraph. Why are there so many churches? Why are there so many different Adventist churches? Used to be just one Adventist church. Now there's all kinds of different kinds of Adventist churches. Why? Did you know why? You're going to find out that the reason is because of lack of humility. Lack of humility and self-denial. I'll read it to you. Here it is. Human reasoning has ever sought to evade or set aside the simple, direct instructions of the Word of God. In every age, how many ages? Every age. What has happened in every age? Okay, here's what's happened. In every age, a majority of the professed followers of Christ have disregarded those precepts which enjoin self-denial and humility. The majority of what? They've disregarded the teachings of Christ that enjoin self-denial, and humility. Okay, that's what the majority of Christians have done in every age. And what is the result of that? Okay, here's what happens. They have disregarded those precepts which enjoin self-denial and humility, which require modesty and simplicity of conversation, deportment, and apparel. The result has ever been the same. Departure from the teachings of the gospel leads to the adoption of the fashions, customs, and principles of the world. Vital godliness gives place to a dead formalism. The presence and power of God withdrawn from those world-loving circles are found with a class of humbler worshipers. So now, what has happened in the church? The church has gotten so worldly that there are some people that are trying to live godly and they can't be part of it, so they're not with them anymore. She says they're a class of humbler worshipers. She says the presence and power of God withdrawn from those world-loving circles are found with a class of humbler worshipers who are willing to obey the teachings of the sacred word. Do you want to obey the teachings of the sacred word? Is that your goal in life? He says, through successive generations, this course has been pursued. So this has been happening through successive generations. And what's the result? Here's the result. One after another, different denominations have risen. Has that happened? Have you studied about that when you studied church history? One after another, different denominations have risen. And yielding their simplicity, have lost in a great measure their early power. Happened over and over and over again. Lost their simplicity. The majority did not maintain humility and self-denial. Church became worldly. The people that were really trying to serve God couldn't be part of that anymore. That's what separated the Waldenses and the Huguenots from the state church of their time. That's what separated the Pauliceans from the church. That's what separated the Hussites from the main church in Czechoslovakia, Czech Republic today. That's what separated the Celtic church from the state church. That's what separated the Lutheran church from the established church. That's what separated the Reformed church from the established church. And then later, it's what separated the Methodist from the Church of England. And it's what separated the Anabaptists. By the way, the Anabaptists were cruelly persecuted by the Protestants. Lutherans put them to death. If you study the history of the Anabaptists, you'll find that their beliefs are almost exactly the same as Seventh-day Adventists today. So how did this happen? Why did it happen? Because of lack of humility, lack of self-control, self-denial, which she says the majority have never followed the professed Christianity. What is God waiting for? Here's what God is waiting for. God has been waiting long for His followers to manifest true humility that He may impart rich blessings to them. God wants to give you rich blessings that you and I don't comprehend at all yet. People say, well, we've been praying for the Holy Spirit. My dear friend, I want to be kind, but it's not going to do you and me one speck of good to pray for the latter rain or the Holy Spirit if we're not humble and if we don't deny ourselves. Jesus said, if anybody wants to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. That was the first requirement he set up. If anybody wants to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross and follow me. The cross was not popular in Jesus' day. And the real cross of Jesus is not popular today either. In closing, I'd like to read to you just a few choice statements about humility. Here's one. Christ is our tower of strength, and Satan can have no power over the soul that walks with God in humility. Would you like to be in a condition where the devil can't have any control over your life? Can't have any power over your life? She says the devil can't exercise any power over somebody that walks with God in humility. But this, humility is a difficult lesson for humanity to learn. Here's another one. Humility is a hard lesson for fallen humanity to learn. Here's another one. It is painful to learn lessons of humility, yet nothing is more beneficial in the end. Why is it so hard? Because of what we think about ourselves. That's why it's so hard. Let me ask you. Don't answer this question to me. Answer it to the Lord. Do you want to learn the lesson? Now you know, friends, that if you and I don't learn the lesson, we won't be in the kingdom of heaven. You do know that, right? The Bible says all the proud people are going to burn up. The only people that will be in heaven are people that are humble. There won't be anybody else there. So this is not something, even though it's a hard sermon to preach and it's hard to practice, it's not something that's not important. It's something that's very important. The Bible says, before honor is humility. If, this is what Ellen White says, if they would cherish true humility, the Lord could do much more for His people, but there are few who can be trusted with any large measure of responsibility or success without becoming self-confident. Would you like to receive much more blessings from God than we're receiving? Will you pray about this? My dear friend, you can't do this for me, and I can't do it for you. But we can each one pray and say, Lord, I'm choosing to humble myself before you, and help me to practice. Remember, if I'm humble, I will practice self-denial for others. The question, of course, is, am I going to learn the lesson? As I watch people, I'm not the judge of how or why things happen, but I believe that many, not all, but many of the troubles and trials and rocky road that we go over in this world is God's allowing things to happen to try to help us to learn this lesson. And it's hard to teach us. We're a hard group. But we have to learn it, friends, if we're going to go to the kingdom of heaven. And I want to learn it. And if you want to learn it too, let's pray before we sing our closing song that the Lord will help us. We will learn. Our Father in heaven, when we review in our minds what Jesus left in glory to come to this world to save us and the humility that He manifested, we are astonished and aghast. And we cannot take it in. We realize as we look to Him that we are rebuked because we do not have this type of humility. But Lord, we want to have it, and we choose to surrender to the working of your Holy Spirit, and we pray that you'll help us, that day by day, that just as Jesus practiced self-denial every day of his life in this world, that we may do the same. You have told us that in the end of time that you are going to have a people, that they are going to be a humble people. Lord, we want to be part of that people. And we pray that we may not be removed from your people because we are offended because of our pride. We pray that your Holy Spirit will work in our hearts and minds and that you'll help us by your grace and power that we might become that meek people, that humble people, that gentle people that will be admitted into the kingdom of heaven. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
We hope that this sermon has been a blessing to you. We would love to hear from you. Our mailing address is Steps to Life, P.O. Box 782-828, Wichita, Kansas 67278. You may call us at 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788. Our email address is historic@stepstolife.org, and our web address is www.stepstolife.org. May God be with you as you seek to walk the narrow way.